Amidst the ancient walls and modern skylines, a haunting symphony of sirens and explosions echo across Israel and Gaza. Families huddle in fear as rockets tear through the night sky, leaving trails of devastation in their wake. The land, scarred by decades of conflict, now stands at a precipice, teetering on the edge of further chaos and loss. Lives are at stake, futures uncertain, and the world watches with bated breath.
The first few days, we got a lot of sympathy in the media, in the press, even in social media. And now I can see the tide beginning to turn, which is ridiculous because the reason people are being displaced in Gaza is because we're warning them. We don't want them to be in harm's way. We are protecting the Gazan civilians. And Hamas, their own elected government, is saying to them, don't move. Why are they asking them not to move and stay in the buildings where they've buried all of their terrorist infrastructure, where they know that we need to dismantle? We need to do anything that any country would do to defend its citizens. And if it was one of their children being kidnapped, would you not want your government to do everything possible to get your child home?
Hamas came to power in 2006 after an election. The people who voted for Hamas, most of them are not around anymore. 70%+ of Palestinians are under 35 years old, didn't even get to vote in those elections. But how is Hamas now popular or less popular? I think in the last 20+ years, there's two factions that are fighting for power in Palestine, Fatah and Hamas, the PA and Hamas. And the PA has not been able to really bring anything, any political development for Palestinians. Hamas in the last 20 years, some Palestinians look at it and say every round of violence it had with Israel, Israel actually conceded to Hamas certain things. And that unfortunately only strengthened Hamas. So it's a lot more complicated than why are people in love with Hamas or not. Also, a reminder, Hamas is an authoritarian regime. It's not a democracy. You don't go out and protest against an authoritarian regime. So you don't see really how much support there is or isn't of Hamas.
We have no choice but to end Hamas's ruling in Gaza. If we don't do that, then our existence will be under great danger. The way to do it is really to make sure that every single Hamas leader, every single Hamas terrorist, whether senior or junior, will be neutralized. That we cannot continue to be terrorized by this vicious terror organization, which have been firing rockets at us for over two decades. I think the world was exposed 10 days ago to the level of viciousness of what Hamas stands for, what kind of values they stand for. Raping children, kidnapping people, elderly, girls with special needs, beheading babies. I mean, this is a level of cruelty that we will not tolerate. Therefore, the Israeli government declared, and I believe that this will be the result. It will take a long time to reach this result. Therefore, we have to end Hamas's control over Gaza. And by the way, the people of Gaza, I'm sure, will be happy to be in that situation.
A glaring failure in global security intelligence allowed Hamas to orchestrate a devastating attack on Israel, prompting crucial questions about potential co-conspirators and the far-reaching implications of this conflict across the region.
The risk of conflict and chaos could spread in other parts of the world, in the Indo-Pacific, in the Middle East, especially in the Middle East. Iran is supporting Russia's in Ukraine, and it's supporting Hamas and other terrorist groups in the region, and will continue to hold them accountable, I might add.
What has happened in the last week is an enormous step up by Hamas. I mean, I don't think anyone expected this from Hamas. This is Hamas starting to tread on Islamic State territory. Hamas has a decision-making point right now. They can choose to go down the Islamic State road, or they can choose to go down another road. Now, that said, let's not forget, Hamas is backed by Iran. In the revolution in 1979 in Iran, when the U.S. embassy was overrun, Iran held on to 100-odd American diplomats and Marines for 444 days. I was in the war when Israel invaded Lebanon in 2006 to get back soldiers taken hostage, and it took 5 years to get those hostages back. So unlike the Islamic State, where I would have a much dire, more sinking feeling in my stomach, I do still hold out hope. It would take patience and it would take compromise, but I pray that there is still hope.
Well, I think we've got to acknowledge it's much stronger and better equipped than we dared imagine. I mean, there's been a major intelligence failure in Israel, both operationally in terms of seeing the breach of the perimeter around Gaza, but also in misreading Hamas. Now, historically, Hamas has it's always kept open the option of using force, and it has been involved in many terror attacks in the past. But there was a sense in the past that the political wing of Hamas, at least, was open to negotiation and didn't want to risk everything, would rather try and negotiate than be caught up in conflict. What we saw happen on the 7th of October and afterwards shows that whether there's been an internal change in Hamas or whatever, we have a very extremely brutal military faction that's very well equipped. There's reports of as many as 1,300 Hamas militants, bodies being found outside Gaza, so very large force that broke through. And it's reported that Hamas may have as many as 30 or 40,000 fighters inside the Gaza Strip, and for only 500 kilometers of tunnels, most of which the IDF doesn't know about. What is clear is that the IDF doesn't have very good human intelligence inside the Gaza Strip. Whatever intelligence it has on the West Bank, it really doesn't understand what's going on inside Gaza very well, and it misread Hamas. So historically, we wouldn't have compared Hamas with a group like Islamic State, but what they did on October 7th, that brutal, not just large scale, but deliberately cruel terror attack targeting women and children, something Hamas has not done as much in the past, that puts them on the level of ISIS in terms of tactics and brutality. And that's a development we didn't see coming.
The central strategic fact of our time is the de facto alliance between China, Russia, Iran and North Korea. So we've got a full-scale crisis in Europe with this brutal invasion of Ukraine by Russia. Now we've got a full-scale crisis in the Middle East with Iran waging war on Israel through its proxies in Hamas and probably in Hezbollah. Now, America has never been more stretched in recent years, and Biden has not increased the defence budget nor increased the American industrial capacity, even though he's been spending trillions of dollars on net zero fantasies and the like. And I wonder if China, which, you know, they just hosted Vladimir Putin in Beijing, I wonder if China is not going to find this a propitious time to take some very aggressive action in the Indo-Pacific in about, you know, in about 6 or 8 weeks' time. I think that's a real possibility.
It's very striking that Biden has come out and said we're four square behind Israel. And of course, it's not a mystery given what was done in southern Israel. Nobody with any common sense, and there's unfortunately quite a few lacking it seems, would do anything but condemn in the most, condign terms, the massacre of about 1,300 civilians and the brutal things that were done to many of them, women, children, elderly people. It's just absolutely horrifying. So morally and psychologically, it's not surprising that Biden would take the stand that he has. But we've already seen that that has implications, because parties other than Hamas, who have mixed views of Israel, should we say, if not hostile ones, wanted to contain this conflict, and the US stepping in and saying we're right there with Israel has put many of their backs up, as we've seen. And of course, behind the scenes, never about to be involved in that summit in Amman, is Tehran. And Tehran is the real wild card in this whole process.
It's interesting, we haven't yet had a statement from Israel saying that Tehran knew about the Hamas attack and was in the loop. The fact they haven't struck Iran yet suggests that Israel is not persuaded that Iran knew what was happening with the Hamas attack. They've certainly funded and equipped and trained Hamas, so there's culpability there. That's an important distinction, because that leaves open the possibility, if that's correct, of back-channel communications with Tehran to dissuade them, to walk them back from the brink, because they pull the strings when it comes to Hezbollah in Lebanon. Now, the fact we've got two US aircraft carriers in the East Mediterranean is a pretty dramatic escalation in terms of a show of force, but that's directed towards Iran and through their proxies, Hezbollah. One of the problems with proxies, however, playing with brutal terrorists as proxies, is you don't always have the control over your proxies that you think you have. And of course, the Revolutionary Guards Corps in Tehran is an excessively brutal terrorist group themselves. So there's a lot that can go wrong. There has been communications, propaganda communications, linked back to the Islamic Revolutionary Guards Corps and their supporters, suggesting they want a regional war, an open confrontation, and this will be the end of Israel as we know it. Now, let's hope that that's not reflective of thinking in Tehran, and let's hope in any case that we can avoid this really bad conflict with this already thousands of lives lost becoming something much, much, much worse. And as I said, the fact we've got two US aircraft carriers in the East Mediterranean is not some idle gesture. It's a pretty big gesture.
From our understanding, it is Iran that is interested in escalating the situation in order to challenge Israel, challenge the IDF and our activities in the south. And that is why they are using the Hezbollah terrorist organization to do so. I would warn Hezbollah to look very carefully. I would also warn the leaders of Lebanon to look very carefully how we are dismantling Hamas in the Gaza Strip, leader by leader, terrorist by terrorist, and indeed infrastructure by infrastructure. We will exert a serious price if they continue to threaten and attack Israel. And nevertheless, we are prepared to fight if needs be on two fronts. We have the ability to do so. We can do it on more fronts as well. And I suggest that Lebanon take control and prevent Hezbollah from continuing their attacks against our people.
We don't yet know whether Iran and the IRGC in particular ordered or directed the particular attack that Hamas undertook on Israel. But what we do know is that Hamas and Hezbollah are financed and supported by Iran through the IRGC, which is the world's largest state sponsor of terrorism. So Iran is intimately involved in these attacks, and Iran would be intimately involved if there's an escalation of these attacks or a broadening of these attacks to other terrorist groups in the region, because they ultimately have enormous influence over them. And the comments that Ayatollah made are incredibly threatening and menacing. And what Iran needs to understand in return is that the resolve of the United States and its allies is also very clear. And there would be very severe consequences, obviously, for Iran if it were to be involved in broadening or widening this conflict.
The Iranians, really, as you mentioned, they are the perpetrators. Without them, the Middle East would have been much, much calmer, more stable, and more peaceful and prosperous. But Iran is not confronting us directly. They're using their proxies, and they're ready to fight until the last Palestinian, until the last Lebanese, until the last Iraqis or Syrian and Yemen, and so on and so forth. So I think once this war is over with Hamas, and maybe with Hezbollah as well, there should be a reckoning in the international community how to proceed with this regime in Iran, which does not represent the people of Iran, but this is like a Nazi-like regime with global aspirations and destruction. It has to be reckoning for Iran.
Well, I got to tell you, we got to look at this event from an international prism.
from a regional prism, not just, let's not narrow it down to Israel versus Gaza. Remember what President Biden said? He said it's not just about the security of Israel. It's about the security of the world and the security of the United States. We've seen countries around the world in the West saying this is our problem. Bear in mind, this is much like the Russian invasion to Ukraine was not a Ukrainian issue. So is the Hamas massacre in Israel. This has become a regional issue, and we would be wise to use it, to take advantage of it and leverage this regional moment where people have to choose. It's like U.S. President George Bush said after 9/11, it's either you're with us or with the terrorists. And now all countries in the region, including Saudi Arabia, considering to normalize relations with Israel, will have to choose. Are you with the Iranian axis harboring Hamas and Hezbollah, or are you with the U.S.-Israeli pragmatic Sunni axis that would set a united front against them? I think all countries in the region would have to change, and these are really tectonic shifts happening all around the region. We have to use this as a regional moment to seize the opportunity and really change the course of the Middle East for generations to come. This is a moment where countries around the region look at the Gaza Strip, but also deduce and translate it into a domestic politics and regional politics. I expect both regional countries and countries around the world to hold Iran responsible and to expect pragmatic Sunni countries like Saudi Arabia to come together with Israel and set a united front against Iran and Hamas.
The Israel war has unleashed a storm of emotions and tensions, where the pain and anger of a conflict has spilled beyond borders. This has led to a surge in anti-Semitic incidents, a tragic echo of history's darkest chapters.
What we're seeing is a global glut, a tsunami of anti-Semitism. It's a 2,000-year-old hatred. We hoped that it would go underground. And after the Holocaust, where the world barely spoke out against 10,000 Jews being murdered every single day. So 10, you had 10 October 7th, every single day for 4 years. The world barely said a thing. No one would even take the Jews in. It went underground a little bit because even the world was shocked by what their own hatred of the Jews led to. And now, three generations after the Holocaust, we're seeing that the world is no longer ashamed, that they're brazen in their anti-Semitism. Australians ought to know that Americans are watching them very closely and are shocked by what they see. We are shocked to hear that people were chanting Jews should be gassed outside of the Sydney Opera House. We are shocked that the Green Party will not condemn the beheading of children. We are shocked that they will not condemn the murder of 270 people at a music festival. Go and try to find a music festival in under Hamas. Anyone that participated, of course, would be shot or imprisoned. We are shocked by what's happening in Australia, and Australians have to reclaim their democracy, because remember, it starts with the Jews. We're the canary in the coal mine. It ends with everybody else. So just know what's coming. Islamists, if they're not stopped, God forbid, you are the next target.
It just throws into chaos the whole concept, the whole idea of anti-racism that everybody's bought into, this whole idea of activism. We must be activists. We must be seen to be anti-racism. We are racist. We must perform all of these gestures. Don't forget, we had in 2020, we had the world coming to a standstill and everybody taking the knee for a criminal in America, George Floyd. Then there was solidarity with the Ukraine. Okay, fair enough. There is nothing now. And yet we are seeing the kind of racism, the kind of naked hatred on the streets of Britain that we have never seen before. These people have, and the institutions as well, institutions like the FA, they're quick to call out racism in some instances. And these are the kind of people who have been shouting, there are Nazis under the bed. You know, women who want female-only spaces have been called Nazis for wanting female-only spaces. And yet, when there are real Nazi approximations here, people who are calling for the extermination of Jews, which Hamas supporters are doing, everybody is silent. The institutions are silent. And it's scary. I'm scared about the future. I'm worried what's going to happen, because if the universities in particular, I'm thinking about the university sector, if they can stay silent Okay, after what's happened in what happened last week in Israel, where children were getting murdered, where bodies were being desecrated, spat on in the streets, where women were being gang raped. If that to them is a complex situation, that doesn't seem to be a complex situation to me. That seems to be the most simple situation in the world. It's wicked. If that is a complex situation and they're seeing evil on both sides, I'm not seeing any evil from the Israelis. If they're seeing evil on both sides, then there is something deeply wrong with our institutions, our morality, our world is upside down.